Hi, welcome back to The Shtick. We're here with Manny Waks on Zoom. He's visiting Melbourne just for a short while, and it's a real pleasure to have you back on The Shtick, Manny.
Always a pleasure, Henry.
Thank you. We've been friends for a long time, and I've followed your journey, and you have a big fan club, but you also have a big detractor club as well, people who find you a little bit radical.
Some of them keep us honest. Some of them are a little bit extreme for my liking, but, you know, you can't please everyone, and everyone's got their own agendas, personalities, whatever it is. Ultimately, I can say, hand on heart, that I try to do the best I can for my community, for victims and survivors of child sexual abuse, to be a decent person. Perhaps I don't always succeed, I don't always get it right, but I make no apologies for trying, I guess.
Well, I just wanted to ask you, what's the latest on the Malka Leifer case?
So on Monday next week, on the 13th of August, of September, sorry, we are going into the committal hearing stage, which is a day many doubted would ever come, because essentially what that means is that Malka Leifer, after many years of trying to get her extradited to Australia, the Australian government has been able to extradite her back from Israel after the Israeli courts, after almost well over 70 court hearings. The Israeli Supreme Court sent Malka Leifer, extradited her back to Australia, and it was all done in under very difficult circumstances, because during COVID times, of course, they had to get her out before the airport, Ben Gurion Airport, was closed. So it's not an insignificant comment to make about that, because there have been obviously issues over the many years that Israel wasn't doing all that it can, and there were so many different challenges along the way, yet at the first opportunity that they could send the Israeli government and the system as a whole ultimately ensured that she was able to be extradited straight away. And ultimately now she's going to be going through the committal hearing, and that process is scheduled for approximately 1 week, with the option of going on for additional days the following week if that's necessary. There are about, as I'm aware, 10 witnesses called to give evidence, including the three sisters, the alleged victims, the complainants in legal language, and they will be cross-examined in a court of law. But this is obviously in COVID times now, it's going to be done via online, and they will be cross-examined, the three sisters, by Malka Leifer's defence team. And from their perspective, I guess, obviously we don't know exactly what angle they're going to take, but it's going to be no surprise if their approach is going to be about trying to focus on discrediting the three courageous sisters and trying to pretend that their client, Malka Leifer, is innocent. So we'll have to wait and see what actually happens, but I do know that it's not a very easy moment, time for those three sisters in particular, their families, and some of the other people who are going to be impacted by it. The courage it takes to go through any judicial process of this kind, and add on top of that the years of fighting just to get Malka Leifer extradited here. They are immensely brave, and one of the reasons I came here is to show solidarity, to show support, to try to send our positive strength and energies to them, and to make sure they're well aware that we're all behind them and hoping for justice.
Talking about behind them, there's a fellow called Yaakov Litzman, who was the health minister.
Yes, absolutely. I mean, the health minister, Yaakov Litzman, the police, and subsequently the attorney general in Israel have decided to indict him. And on part of the crimes, the alleged criminal activity involved him trying to influence the outcome of the Malka Leifer case to try to prevent her, allegedly, try to prevent her from being extradited here. So it's going to be a great development when that actually happens. But the positive news is that Israel is not letting go of this issue. They are pursuing justice with all those involved. And at the same time, we absolutely expect the Australian police, the Victorian police, to pursue all those who were involved in covering up these alleged crimes, in aiding and abetting an alleged criminal back then in 2008. And this is evidence that has already been given in a civil court, and a civil judge has already said and understood and accepted the fact that the Adas leadership actually deliberately covered up and sent her overseas. So it seems to us that there is sufficient grounds for the police to hopefully pursue this matter, and hopefully we will see those people held to full account and justice to prevail, both with Malka Leifer, those who tried to prevent justice from happening, and those who were involved in covering up and getting us to the stage that where we are today.
Yeah, well, up till this point, I have literally not mentioned the name of Malka Leifer, mainly because the shtick really works on giving our community a positive image. And I think that this whole child sex abuse, besides having you on years ago and having you on since then, because you were here not that long ago, 4 years ago for the healing event, you remember?
Yes, I do.
That was pretty amazing. That was an incredible, that was a real moment of trying to reconcile, because we're here to give our community a good image, not to create division or derision amongst ourselves, because what we have enough people trying to give us a hard time. And this week in Rosh Hashanah, we had a prayer event at Adas, which is also related to Malka Leifer's connection.
Mainstream Adas, if you can call anyone associated with Adas mainstream. They are certainly an ultra-Orthodox sect group, very close community. But this prayer group that we're referring to is an even more extreme sect, a breakaway group from there, who essentially, as you rightly point out, flattered the law and brought the entire Jewish community into disrepute, because it is too difficult for us, for the broader community, to understand the subtleties, the nuances, the differences. And yet here we have a few handfuls of Jews, ultra-Orthodox Jews, flouting the law, endangering the public, endangering themselves. And from my perspective, it's not only about that. To me and to many of my colleagues, the issue here is much deeper. It is ultimately an illustration of their mentality, their attitude, and the actions they ultimately take in the broader context, in their day-to-day lives. They do believe they're above the law. And that's how we do end up having these situations like child sexual abuse, or lack of women's rights, or lack of freedoms. So these are much broader issues that we have now seen manifested itself in these illegal minyanim, which is absolutely contemptible, and hopefully the full justice will prevail with them as well.
In every religion, there is a radical element. And in our religion, we have the radical extreme left and we have an extreme right. Now, the Haredi people, they believe that God is above the law. That's what they believe. But in general, our community, we live with the law of the land.
Correct. Right. The vast majority in our community are not Orthodox. They may be affiliated with synagogues, but they are not practicing Orthodox Jews. Certainly not the ultra-Orthodox, who about 2%, less than 5% of our community. So put that in perspective, the community of over 120,000 members across Australia, and about 60,000 of them in Melbourne. You've got a small fraction, a few dozen families in this particular instance. But at the same time, let's not completely ignore the fact that there are other illegal minyanim happening in Australia, and for that matter, around the world. I'm aware of some of them, many others. There's got to be careful about, unless you have evidence, and there's always potential for defamation and the like. But we do know that they exist. And the others have just been smarter in actually trying to find ways where they won't be caught. But it's that mentality that is across the board in the ultra-Orthodox community, which is the problem that we end up seeing manifested in a range of ways.
Well, we want to try and get you back before you go away so you can keep us up to date with the Leifer case. And it's been really great to have you on. I did want to mention your dear brother, Rabbi Schneer Waks, or Retty Waks, as he's known now. And he's got a page on Facebook called Rabbi Without Borders.
Exactly.
And he did a couple of days of service with Simon Starr and Alex Burkoy, which I watched because I was stuck at home, except for
a little. The rest of us. I tuned in for a little bit as well.
Of course, I noticed. And besides going to Caulfield Park to do Tashlich and hear the shofar, in fact, I got woken up by a shofar outside my window on the first day. So I wanted to wish you Shana Tova, and looking forward to seeing you in person, which I'm sure we will at some stage before you leave. We'll be going into the next segment with a fellow called Johnny Landis, who has formed a group called the Chevra Honey. And they're making honey. He is the actual beekeeper. And we'll be meeting him and talking about how his honey went over Rosh Hashanah. In fact, we're still doing the sweet thing, aren't we?
Absolutely. We'll continue doing sweetness and whatever else we need to do to ensure people are still smiling in these very difficult times. Henry?
Correct. Thank you, Manny.
Shana tova.
Shalom, shalom.